Hello and welcome to Show of the Week. I'm Mike.
And I'm Andy. This week I got into the holiday spirit by decorating a festive tree in Minecraft. Which Mike then burned down.
Every year, man, thus making it a beloved holiday tradition. While you were doing that, I was playing Ubisoft's new racing game, The Crew.
Oh, do you like racing games, Mike? You think you'd have mentioned it?
Is this about the tree?
Yes, it's about the tree!
All right, well, while you calm down, Andy, I'll continue colouring in The Crew's ridiculously huge game world. The entire continental United States has been squeezed and compressed into a drivable sandbox, filled with other players driving their own disgustingly decorated rides. The world isn't just huge, but it's insanely detailed too. Los Angeles looks like Los Angeles, Miami looks like Miami, and Roswell, New Mexico looks like, well, like a town still dining out on a 1940s UFO myth. There are a few weird omissions. Boston isn't there, for example, and I understand that's quite a large, significant American city. Nor is San Diego, though they did find time to model that nuclear power station that looks like a pair of breasts on the way to San Diego. Oh, Ubisoft. Still, the cruise version of America is massive, so much so that it'll take you an hour or so to drive coast to coast. A bit like Test Drive Unlimited, of which this is a sort of spiritual sequel, it's filled with other players going about their automotive business, and just cruising around with one or two friends is rewarding in and of itself. Basically, this is not your granddad's racing game. A bit like Destiny, it's always online, and introduces mechanics traditionally associated with MMOs like World of Warcraft into a new genre. What this basically means is that your car handles like a buttered brick to start with, but by winning events you increase its level until it's an all-conquering grippy hypercar. It's a different progression system from what you might be expecting from an arcade racing game, but it's compelling in its own way. You can buy new cars, but the really desirable ones are phenomenally expensive unless you're prepared to get involved in the mucky world of microtransactions. Otherwise, you'll be modifying your existing ride to keep up with the rising difficulties of races.
Yo, just so we're clear, winner gets to lose his ride.
You got it!
And if you really need a crappy Need for Speed-style story about a wrongly convicted racer out for revenge, that's in there too. Troy Baker stars as someone's dad, I guess? Still, the adventures of the world's fastest geography teacher provide a vital bit of framing and inspiration for the story missions, which as it turns out are varied and exciting. Oh, and they can be played in co-op too if you have a petrolhead buddy to play with. And once you've solved those, some 25 to 30 hours later, you can attempt to polish off the faction missions, which are this game's take on the huge raids that are usually the toughest challenge in an MMO. The longest race is a staggering 4 hours long, which should be just enough time for Andy to have cooled off about that tree.
So yeah, I think I'm about ready for another CarPG.
What?
CarPG. It's a genre, like RPG, but with cars.
That's not a genre, Mike. You can't make up a genre just because car sounds like the letter R.
It's a real thing, I swear.
Look, I can totally prove it, Jane. Alright, there's not many of these CarPGs, but in the same way that chocolate-covered pretzels shouldn't work, but totally do, when a racing game and an RPG love each other very much, wonderful things can happen. Road Trip Adventure takes place in a cutesy open world where, presumably, some sort of apocalyptic event has wiped out the entire human race and sentient cars are the new rulers of Earth. Your objective is to earn licenses and tune your car to the point where you can beat the president, who is a Lincoln Town Car, obv, and assume the title of Carmander-in-Chief for yourself. Carmander doesn't really work, does it? Anyway, if grinding to make your car halfway drivable doesn't appeal, you can always play the mini-games like three-a-side football or car curling. Carling? That's a drink, isn't it? Somebody stop me. Squadra Corps Alfa Romeo would be a pretty forgettable racing game if it wasn't for the inclusion of a load of RPG-inspired driver attributes. My favourite is Tiger Effects, though. I'd like it better if it caused a live tiger to teleport into your opponent's car. Instead, it's a sort of time rewind for when you fluff a corner. There's also a driver condition attribute, which is depleted if an opponent is following too closely. It's a sort of artificially amplified buildup of pressure from the car behind, the symptoms of which seem to be exactly the same as those of a heart attack. Probably worth getting a checkup from your doctor before you embark on that high-intensity career as a professional racing driver. Even if you consider yourself a huge Need for Speed fan, it's unlikely you've played Need for Speed World, which is a PC-only MMO racer from back in the days when it was acceptable to use the word freemium. It smushed together Rockport and Palmont from Full Fat Need for Speed's Most Wanted and Carbon, and is a sort of early stab at what the crew is going for. The difference being, EA struggles that bit harder not to ruin their game with microtransactions. It's still going and still free to play, if you're curious, but hasn't been properly supported for the last couple of years. Made by the key people behind the crew before they left to set up Ivory Tower, Test Drive Unlimited was one of the first games, racing or otherwise, to seamlessly blend single and multiplayer. It's basically a rich tosser simulator, allowing you to cruise around Hawaii in expensive cars and buy massive condos so that when you're not cruising around Hawaii in expensive cars, you can sit and watch videos of expensive cars on the television. But then, who doesn't secretly want to be a rich tosser if it means you get to drive a Ferrari Enzo around a tropical island?
Just bring it back in good condition.
Even if it is technically someone else's. JRPG Masters Square Enix had a crack at combining racing with RPGs back in 1999 with the story-driven Racing Lagoon. Inspired by the street racing manga Initial D, the game took the unique approach of having separate overworld maps, a bit like Square Enix's Final Fantasy games. This being a Japanese racing game from the 90s, that means cruising between races to the sound of smooth fusion jazz. And if you encounter other street racers on your travels, a quick flash of the headlights initiates a race on a circuit made up of the local streets. Just don't try that in a quiet car park after dark, kids. It means a totally different thing.
Now it's time to see what you've been saying in the comments and adding to my mulled wine recipe. Mike, you can't add Jägermeister to mulled wine.
Not with that attitude, you can't. First up, your comments on Never Alone, which is a charming retelling of the Inuit folktale that apparently includes an awful lot of fox drownings.
I'll save you.
Yeah.
Oh. Fox. Fox, no. Impatient Fox.
Seriously, Fox.
Cerberus Lives was so impressed with our performance, they had to rewrite the old typing exercise, saying, "The quick brown fox may have jumped over the lazy dog, but the overly quick white fox jumped three dogs and a polar bear before plummeting into freezing water and becoming a foxicle."
Aziz Kadimi puts it more succinctly, saying, "For fox's sake, you guys are bad at keeping the fox alive."
Finally, Owen Spores says, "You see, this is why the wall was built, although what urged John and Ghost to go onto the other side this time is beyond me."
I thought I recognised that fox from somewhere. It's good to see he's getting work outside of Game of Thrones. Another game we've been playing this week is Micro
Toy Box.
Machines?
Turbos. Toy Box Turbos.
Shoot him with guns! Mines everywhere!
Shoot Mike with guns!
Victory!
Oh, what?
Tolly Zora Naraya takes time out of her busy schedule of running the Normandy's engineering deck and smooching Commander Shepard to say, "And I thought the Hamilton versus Rosberg rivalry was intense, lol. P.S. Well done, Lewis."
Do they get motorsport in deep space and the future?
Apparently.
Sweet. Seems we also caused a revelation for Joe Stinton, who realised, "This is why my bus is always late. It spent all of its time rolling over or spinning in puddles."
No, don't get drift.
Don't get drift the bus.
No,
everything at once.
Minor delays will be occurring on the rest of this route. The decisive BD Productions 13 steps in to offer this definitive opinion. "I'm not sure what I'm watching. I'm not sure what's going on, but I think I like this game, maybe."
Cool. Finally this week, your comments on the Far Cryathlon video in which we ski jumped a tuk-tuk into a pit of angry bears.
Incredibly
stay
fast.
On target.
Oh, why did I take the bear pit?
Bear pit.
Yes!
Oh no,
bear attack. Kiwi Kyla 1 says, "I still hear Mike scream at 7:40 ringing in my head, help."
Did you kill the elephant?
No, I think that was...
Looks a bit surprised.
Yeah, that was the elephant, actually.
You monster.
Sorry, as Mr. Man Guy says, proof that elephants improve all sporting events.
I don't know. As Ryan Henderson points out, well, I think we all know now why Kirat doesn't score well in the Winter Olympics.
When are the IOC going to recognise exploding animal ski jump as an official Olympic sport?
According to their press office, please stop writing to us, Ms. Douglas.
All right, well, I'm going to head back in. I think Andy's calmed down by now.
All right. Dear International Olympic Committee, have you considered the angry dog death maze? You could make it Winter Olympics by replacing the dogs with polar bears.
That's it for Show of the Week, but I have it on good authority that a press of the like button is a big nice on the Santa scale, so you're probably going to want that this close to the holiday season.
We'll be back next week with a festive special, but until then, you can get in touch on Twitter and Facebook. See you next time. Look, I got you this tree to say sorry.
Man, thanks. That's awesome.
What can I say? Holiday tradition.